One major component we have to ask is, what is our end goal? What are we trying to accomplish? Inevitably, what does an air conditioner do? The answer to that is we're transferring heat in its simplest form. We're using a medium, what we call refrigerant, to take heat in from a space, put it in that medium, and we're taking it out to a different space and putting it out into a different medium. So inside refrigerant, back outside. That's really all it is. But my question is what is heat itself? It's a form of energy. That's all it is. It's legitimately just a group of atoms bouncing against each other at a set rate of speed. And they have X amount of speed as they hit the next atom beside it. And we get into basics of thermodynamics, and we're talking about everything moves from a higher energy point to a lower energy. We don't go from low energy to high, we go from high to low. So when we talk about we're going from hot to cold, that's exactly what we're describing. So many times we look at these scenarios as overly simplified, and they are very simple. They are. But we lose track of how we can properly apply them when we start doing a troubleshoot. Your ability to understand what is physically happening in a refrigeration cycle and in a refrigeration system, whether, you know, despite the application, is going to come down to your ability to understand this thing at an atomic level. Just end of the day, all we're doing is we're moving energy. When we talk about we're moving heat, you know, we open it up with that segment, that's all we're doing. What we refer to as sensible heat. Sensible heat is being generated because of our bodies and because of these lights currently. Those are the major loads. Then we talk about the heat on the other side of that wall penetrating through the wall, and it's also adding heat because that's an exterior wall, right? So these are creating heat sources, so we need to remove some of that energy that's getting absorbed by the atoms in this air. And we need to move that energy somewhere we don't care about, back to outside. That is the core fundamental of everything in this trade. Why we use the economizers we use, why we transfer heat the way we transfer it, why the coils respond the way they do. A lot of the times it's so easy to take it to the extreme of, well, it's refrigerant, it's all this science, it's these chemicals, and you get so wrapped up in what the system is supposed to be that you begin to lose sight of the core fundamental of what is it trying to do. And then you start to lose sight of just basic heat transfer principles. You walk up to a system, it's got an outside air economizer, it's got a reheat coil, you know, it's got this enthalpy wheel, it's got these different components that are affecting how the system is operating. And it becomes very overwhelming because you become so hyper-focused on these components that you begin to lose sight of why these components exist. Why does that reheat coil in there? Why is that enthalpy wheel or heat recovery wheel, why is it spinning? Why is it not spinning? Why? And that's really what it boils down to is heat, energy. What are we physically trying to move the energy with? We have to create some kind of differential to have movement. Why do we even need to flow the refrigerant through that coil? Again, we need to create a differential in the mediums. Why does the type of evaporator even matter? Whether it be microchannel or tube and fin or made of aluminum, made of copper and aluminum, right? Why does any of this matter? It's ability to move energy is where it all ties in. It's the foundation of this entire trade mixed with the air itself. We think about sensible energy all the time. That's where our brains go to is. But what's the other type of energy that exists in this air that plays a factor into the bigger picture? You have sensible and you have latent heat. Both play an equal part. One is not more than the other. We get so hyper-focused on sensible because it's the most familiar to us. And it's honing in on a component. Sensible heat is just one component of that airstream, and we completely negate the second component, which is the latent. That we lose sight of what it is we're trying to troubleshoot, and we're sitting there wondering why it doesn't make sense when you're only looking at half of the picture, because you're not understanding the foundation of the fact of we're just moving energy. and anything else we talk about, when we get into saturation, we get into superheat, we get into subcooling, we get into all these higher level principles, they mean nothing if you don't properly understand what that energy is trying to do to begin with. These are the three major variables that plays into what makes that coil function. So I'm not gonna go into a crazy design function here. Where I'm going with it is that magic saturation temp. Why does that saturation temp matter, and how is it affected depending on the coil itself? And this is where we start talking about system efficiencies, whether it's a high efficiency, low efficiency, 13 SEER, 25 SEER, whatever. All of that plays into this number, whether we're trying to run 40 or 55. Which one is it? Which one is correct? Because if you walk up to a system that's trying to operate at 55 degrees of evaporator saturation, and you want it to run at 40, and you're thinking something's wrong, when there's nothing wrong. It's doing exactly what it's designed to do. That plays into how we're using these three things to achieve that. This is where microchannels have become very popular, is we can have a lot more surface area with less refrigerant and move the same amount of CFM to achieve a higher saturation in the same BTU capacity. So if we have an evaporator that's rated for 60K BTUs on our condenser side, do we just need a condenser rated for 60,000 BTUs? Inevitably, these won't be numbers you'll ever have to deal with, but you need to pay attention, just understand it. That outdoor unit, the same way with like a cooling tower on a commercial loop, has more than just what that coil is taking in. It has their friction and heat infiltration on the line set. It has the compressor cooling. It also has to process. On top of the fact, if it loses any kind of coil efficiency, so its ability to physically cool that refrigerant, though your outdoor unit may be rated for 60,000, but that's with all these other variables built into it. So it may actually be a 70,000 labeled as a 5-ton. But that's because the engineering already went in and spec'd that extra 10,000 BTUs of additional load for you. They do the same thing with cooling towers. Cooling towers have to be sized so much above what the equipment itself is rated for. So we got a chiller, for instance, or a self-contained water source heat pumps, you name it. Additional loads in that loop can be the pumps themselves. You know, that pump running and is generating, even if the motor's outside of the water loop, which usually it is, but that pump itself is generating a lot of heat. Stop flowing water on a pump one day and let it sit long enough. That thing will get burning hot. So you have that, then you have the friction of the water moving through the pipes. That itself, I've had loops get to over 100 degrees because the equipment shut down on a chill water loop, because the equipment shut down and the pump was allowed to just run on its own without anything cooling it. Just the friction of the pipe and the pump itself was enough to raise that water well over 100. So far over 100 that it ruptured all of the thermometers on the loop. So those are additional loads that tower has built into it. So they already know, I think it's 25% or 30% over. So when you buy a 100,000 BTU tower, you're actually purchasing a 130,000 BTU tower. So the same principle happens with a regular condenser system. And you can calculate exactly how many BTUs any system is moving at any given time. I don't remember the formulas right offhand, but I used to do this for people. When they would want to do critical energy audits, you could go in and calculate based off of your latent heat and your sensible heat that was removed, And then you factor your electrical loads on your compressor and condenser fan. You calculate that into the total BTU percentage, and I could tell you exactly your evaporator is pulling in X amount of BTUs. Your condenser and your fan are drawing X amount of BTUs into the system, and you're running at this rated amount. End of the day, air conditioning. It is just the process of conditioning air or product of some kind. That's really all it is. That is the foundation. So we want this one cubic foot to be at a set parameter, whether it be 73 with a 50% humidity or whatever it is that you find comfortable. That is different person to person. But end of the day, this is what we want. This is our end product. So everything that we do, every decision we make, how much air we push through each of those vents, and what size system we decide to put behind it that pushes it, from the engineering level up, is all decided on this one cubic foot of air. We call that psychrometrics. Say you had 70 degree dry bulb or sensible heat, but you had a 70% relative humidity. Are you gonna have a higher or lower saturation with those readings? Okay, let me take it a step further. If you had 75 dry bulb with a 50% relative humidity, which one of these would be higher? This one?
Because of the relative humidity, right?
I would venture to say that they'll probably be about the same. You would probably get a 40 to 45 degree saturation out of both coils. It comes down to the physical energy in the air. It doesn't matter whether that energy is in a sensible state or latent state. Energy is energy. That is what is being absorbed into the refrigerant stream through the CFM, through the air we're moving. Inevitably, we're still moving the same amount of BTUs and we're not underloading the coil. If this relative humidity at 70 degree return was down to say 50, the same as this, you might see a 40 degree coil turn into 38, 37 real quick. And it can't maintain the 40 because the latent load has dropped off. So you may walk up to a system that has a lower sensible load, but it has a real high latent load, and you're still going to maintain a proper coil temperature that you're looking for because of the latent heat added. That goes back to one of my early points of where we get so hyper-focused in on just these sensible points that we begin to, it starts to not make sense because we're not paying attention to the whole picture. There's two forms of heat being absorbed into any coil, and they're rated for such. Because when you sit down and you actually graph these on a psychrometrics chart and you look at BTUs per pound, it doesn't matter how either of these numbers roll, up, down, sideways, left, right, the BTUs per pound stays the same. Most any higher efficiency system, if I had to throw a number, anything like 17 SEER and above, is typically going to run a higher saturation coil. Because one of the major ways that we achieve higher SEER ratings is we reduce compression ratio. Which is one reason why you've got 5-ton condenser coils that used to be this tall, now they're this tall. They had to add surface area to increase heat transfer to lower the differential between ambient and saturation, which lowered the compression ratio. But it also cost a lot more because they had to add extra material to get the same amount to get the desired result. You don't know how to calculate compression ratio. You essentially just divide your discharge pressure by your suction pressure. That gives you your compression ratio. Once you start exceeding on the high end of that ratio, you've got a very inefficient system. But at the same time, you can't go too low on that number, because what does it mean when your compression ratio is 1? you're not pumping squat. What do we call a compression ratio of 1 or near 1? Say it's 1.2. It's inefficient. Valves are bad. Plates shattered. We go down the list. That compressor has failed somehow, so we can utilize compression ratio to determine that. Or just one of many factors. At the end of the day, you can just look at your gauges. You're not getting much pump. You know, it's not flowing much right there. It doesn't pull your suction down much. Your high side doesn't really increase much at all every time the compressor turns on. It just sits there and spin, and you don't have any amp draw on it either. It doesn't have any load against it. Because the more load that compressor has, the higher those amps are going to go. So you have no load, you have no compression, inefficient compressor. Compressor ratio is just another way of stating that. And one thing I will warn you, the deeper we get into modern systems that have these advanced electronic controls, they are looking more and more at ratios like that. And they're actually getting built into literature. Now, we've been dealing with compression ratios on the chiller side for years. That's always been something we've had to look at. But I've even gone as far as to see these VRV systems are starting to document compression ratio. And as part of the troubleshooting in there, and you pull up their software and log into them with a laptop, and they'll give you the ratio readouts. I mean, that's all they're doing. They're just doing the math for you. But the point is, they put that reading in there because it means something. The deeper we get into this variable speed world, the more those types of things are going to matter. Because that could also play into how well are you cooling that compressor. Because again, you lose too much ratio, you're not moving enough. Say the condenser coil was starting to get dirty, or the metering device wasn't working so well, or you lost airflow on the indoor. More specifically, the condenser coil gets dirty. I think that's probably the easiest example. You're going to see that start to creep up. And so we may go out and do a PM, and you do the compression ratio mentally in your mind, or you write it down somewhere, and it's 2.2 this PM. Everything looks perfect. All right. You come back 6 months later, do another PM on it, it's gone to 2.5. Why? Why did that ratio increase?
Because our head pressure went up and our head pressure stayed
low. You turn around, you clean that condenser coil, that head pressure, pew, right back down. That is why we started to see these higher saturations on coils. So you have coils out there now that are designed to run 50 to 55 degrees of saturation, and that's what they're specifically meant for. So you walk in, you see you're running 55 degrees of saturation, your superheat's rocking and rolling at 12 degrees, everything in the system looks fine, but I don't get why am I running such high saturation? Do I have am I going to start having a humidity issue at this point because my saturation is not low enough? Because again, if our goal is energy transfer and we have to absorb the latent energy, we have to get that saturation low enough that latent energy is attracted enough to condensate that moisture out of the air, right? So is this saturation going to cause a humidity issue? Because if you try to run a 48, 50 degree saturation on a standard efficiency system, say 13 SEER, you're probably going to have a humidity issue. But you get a 17, 18 SEER system in there with a coil that's designed for that, it's absorbing enough of that latent energy and it's not having to take as much as the sensible. It's able to perform the same job at a higher coil temperature. Which, again, goes back to compression ratio. Because now we run a higher suction pressure and we put a bigger condenser coil outside and we drop that down, the condenser saturation. So where we used to run 30 degree saturation differentials, now we're only doing 15. So we cut that in half. That compression ratio goes from being normal 2.5 to 2. And then that compressor normally ran 10 amps, now runs 7 or 8. What is the outdoor unit's job, the condenser specifically? What is the condenser's job?
To